Ejenta means agent in Bengali, and our mission is to apply AI and intelligent agent technology to make healthcare accessible for all. I'm Rachna, Dhamija. I'm the founder and CEO of Ejenta.
My name is Maarten Sierhuis, and I'm the CTO and co-founder of Ejenta.
We are using intelligent agent technology that my co-founder developed at NASA for remotely monitoring astronauts. An intelligent agent, essentially, it's an autonomous software program, and it's able to sense data from its environment, it's able to reason, it's able to learn, and then it can take action autonomously on behalf of its users. So let's say a patient has a weight scale and a blood pressure monitor, maybe an activity tracker. That agent is always monitoring that data and then trying to predict the patient's health based on the data that we collect in the home and then based on data that we also collect from the patient's medical record. Then the intelligent agents can reach out to a healthcare provider. For example, to give the health provider an alert that a patient might need help or their health is deteriorating. And we give every patient on our platform their own intelligent agent that's continuously monitoring data about them, that learns about them, that predicts their health, and that can help their health providers to intervene before a negative event happens. Maarten and I were both going through similar things with our families. My dad was pretty ill and far away, and it was hard to take care of him. And his mother had the same issue. She had a chronic condition and was in the Netherlands. So we ended up talking about that problem a lot. So Maarten had told me a joke.
It would be easy if our parents could wear spacesuits because then I could monitor him, you know, at a distance, just like our astronauts.
And then we realized, actually, we have all of the technology that is in the spacesuit that we could bring to, you know, in our parents' homes and make it a reality. So we're kind of turning the healthcare system on its head by making care continuous and predictive and preventative rather than episodic.
Brahms is actually a multi-agent programming and modeling, human behavior modeling language. You can both simulate things in Brahms, so simulate human behavior, and then also implement those simulations as real systems. Brahms is named after the composer, and I always say work is like a symphony, well rehearsed, but always different. It's had its origins in actually studying workflow systems in organizations. In the early 2000s is when we started actually modeling and researching the astronauts from the Apollo missions on the moon. And then I really started to understand how this relationship between people in mission control on Earth were collaborating and coordinating the work on the moon with the astronauts. When knowledge becomes important is when things go wrong. And then it was, the key moment was then, how do you build systems that can actually incorporate that type of knowledge and can react to things that are not something that happens every day? It's not about all the things that go right, you know, that is the simple part. It's about what does the system do when it goes wrong. Then we got a request from you know, JPL, Jet Propulsion Laboratory, to help them with the design of mission operations for the Mir mission, for Spirit and Opportunity on Mars. We started with moving the simulation to a real Mars-like environment, and we used the Mars Desert Research Station in Utah to create an environment where we lived like we would live on Mars, with robots, communication back to mission control. Mission control wanted to monitor the health of the astronauts in the spacesuit while we were in the desert. So we built this agent that would, with sensors in the spacesuit for our astronauts, monitor that and send that information to the doctor in mission control. That research actually led to mission control for the International Space Station asking us to use this technology to help them create automation in mission control. And it's still running 24/7, you know, for the International Space Station. You know, I have moved on to bring this technology to Earth and to the real world. And for me, that is healthcare. You know, I want to solve problems that you know, that have an impact for humankind here on Earth.
So we approached NASA for a license agreement and then developed a proof of concept. I think that took about 6 months to a year. Introducing new technology to healthcare takes a long time because you have to prove, you have to validate that it works and that it's safe. So we've gone through a number of clinical trials and we're now at the stage where we're deploying and scaling.
I always had this feeling, if I can create a computer system running in mission control for NASA, I could get it running in somebody's home, right? But that still, that was a long journey to get that working. There was this distinct moment when our first patient got online with a real clinical trial with a healthcare organization. And that was a pivotal moment because that proved to me that we could actually do it, you know? And it actually worked. It was actually in the hands of somebody, you know, somewhere in the United States, and we were getting data and collecting data and helping that patient stay home healthy.
And now we're trying to really scale and grow the company and make this a reality. We're working with TRISH, which is the Translational Research Institute for Space Health at Baylor College of Medicine, and working closely with NASA as well to take what we've done, which started off with Maarten's technology for monitoring astronauts in space. We brought it back to Earth, and now we're bringing it back to space for long-duration spaceflight. So if you look at one of the problems we're solving in long-duration spaceflight, you have an astronaut who's in a really contained environment. He's in deep space, doesn't have a lot of contact with his family, or if he does, there's a 20-minute time delay. And so there are a lot of behavioral issues that arise from that. There are a lot of potential impacts on health. But if you think about the patient who's isolated at home, the issues can be very similar. Advances that we make in helping astronauts for long duration spaceflight do have implications for developing technology at home.
I still feel that AI is, you know, at the early stage. And one example I can give is just how we communicate through voice with AI agents at the moment. Humans have conversations. Humans have history and memory about a conversation. It's not just I ask a question and you give an answer. It's just the way we interact as humans. It's so fluent and you know, it's based on common ground. And this common ground is what I think AI systems still, they don't have this common ground. And so therefore the interaction between me and my agent is still very awkward. And you know, to make this into the holy grail that I have in my mind, you know, we need to develop a lot more capability.
So we're just in the early phases now where we're deploying our technology with patients with chronic conditions. The end goal is to make this available to everybody. So not just people who are chronically ill, not just the sickest of us, but to people who are healthy to prevent them from getting ill in the first place.